Hi dear students, good morning to all. Hope you are all fine. Please take much care in this pandemic situation and let us hope for that day when we will meet in our classroom itself. In our last class, we have discussed about atomic number of an element, mass number, and how to calculate number of protons, number of electrons, and number of neutrons in an atom. And we also studied about drawing Bohr models of different atoms. Today, we are continuing our discussion into the periodic properties of elements. As we all know that in our periodic table we have as much as 118 elements. All these elements are arranged in this modern periodic table based on particular criteria known as the modern periodic law. All these elements have their own characteristic properties, and today we are discussing about these characteristic properties and how they are changing. So before getting into today's class, let me show you the model of an atom. Here is your atom. Have a deep look into it. Now you have to find out the atomic number, mass number, and the number of protons, electrons, and neutrons of this given atom. And your time starts now. Okay, students, I hope you all have finished the work. Let me call Arjun. Yes, Arjun, tell me which atom was that? You're very good. It was sodium atom. Okay, tell me Arjun, what is the atomic number of that sodium atom? Atomic number is 11. Is here right? Very good. You made very good approach. That's right, Arjun. Tell me how to represent atomic number using the symbol. Very good. We are represent atomic number by using the symbol Z. And here the atomic number of sodium atom is? Very good. And what about the mass number? Very good. The mass number of sodium atom is 23. Very good. Okay, please Arjun, take a speech and let me call Dia. Okay, Dia, tell me, how many protons are present in the sodium atom? The number of protons? Number of protons equal to 11. Okay, 11. Have you got it? It's very good. The number of protons in an atom is always equal to the atomic number of that atom. So, the atomic number of sodium is 11. As he said, the number of protons in sodium will also be 11. And we have to a good approach. Very good, dear. Then what about the number of electrons? Number of electrons is equal to 11. Very good. See? Yes. Number of protons, number of electrons, and the atomic number of a neutral atom are always equal. Very good. And finally, the number of neutrons. Finally, the number of neutrons in the sodium atom is 12. 12. Have you got it? Yes, very good. We know that in order to get the number of neutrons, we have to subtract the atomic number from 10 mass number. So by subtracting atomic number from mass number, we will get the number of neutrons in any atom. And here, since the mass number is 23 and the atomic number is 11, by subtracting them, 23 minus 11, we will get the number of neutrons as 12. A very good idea. You too, please take your seat. So, you all are thorough about our previous class, how to find the number of atoms. Sorry, the atomic number, mass number, number of protons, electrons, and neutrons in an atom. Okay, now, let me divide you into 5 groups. So, please start your counting from 1 to 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And likewise, okay. Please rearrange yourself. Group 1 members are here, group 2 and group 3. And group members are here, group 4 members are here, and finally, there the group 5 members. Okay. Now, let me give you the names of some atoms. You have to draw the Bohr models of those atoms. You have to draw the Bohr models of those atoms. And the atoms are potassium, fluorine, chlorine, hydrogen, carbon, and finally calcium. You have to draw the Bohr models of all these 6 atoms. Okay, your time is up. Have you finished? It's very good. So let us check one by one. First of all, let us start from potassium. Okay, keep your finding to yourself potassium. First of all, we are going to deal with potassium. So group 3 members, what is the atomic number of potassium? Very good, 19. Very good. So the atomic number of potassium is 19. Very good. Group 4. Tell me, what is the first step in order to draw the Bohr model? Yes, very good. First of all, we have to write the electronic configuration. Okay, tell me, what is the electronic configuration of this potassium atom? Potassium has an electronic configuration of 2, 8, 8, 1. Very good. Second group number. How many electrons are present in the different shapes of this potassium atom? It's very good. In its shell, it has 2 electrons. In its L shell, it has 8 electrons, and in its M shell, it has 8 electrons, and in its N shell, it has 1 electron. So, as a conclusion, first group members, please tell me how many shells are present in this potassium atom? Yes, there are 4 shells. Is there any doubt? Yeah, very good. So in potassium, we have 4 shells, namely K, L, M, and N. So we have 4 shells. Okay. Fifth group members. What about carbon? What is the atomic number of carbon? Yes, very good. The atomic number of carbon is atomic number of carbon is 6. Very good. What is the electronic configuration? Carbon has an electronic configuration of 2, 4. So how many electrons are present there? In the K shell, carbon has 2 electrons, and in the L shell, it has 4 electrons. So as a whole, how many shells are present in this carbon atom? Very good. There are two shells in the carbon atom, namely K shell and L shell. So in carbon atom, the K shell has 2 electrons and the L shell has 4 electrons. So we have our potassium and carbon with alpha. Now let us draw their Bohr model. Okay, so let us draw their Bohr model. So first, in the case of potassium, first of all, let me draw the very good nucleus. And in the nucleus, we have protons and neutrons. And our K shell, L shell, M shell, and N shell. Since potassium has 4 shells, I have drawn all the 4 shells, and now we are going to insert the electrons. In the K shell, we have 2 electrons, right? And in the N shell, we have 8 electrons. Am I right? Yes. And in the M shell also, we have 8 electrons. And finally, in the N shell, we have only 1 electron. So, this is the Bohr model of potassium atom. Please verify with your own findings also. So, is it clear? Yes, so this is the Bohr model of potassium atom. And what about the carbon atom? Let us know. The nucleus, which has both protons and neutrons. And around that nucleus, we have our K shell and then L shell. Because carbon has only 2 shells, namely K and L. And in the K shell, we have only 2 electrons. And in the L shell, we have 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 electrons. So that is the Bohr model of carbon atom. So here we have our Bohr models of respectively potassium and carbon atoms. Have you seen any difference in these two structures? Yes, there are many differences. So just have a look into these figures and also the Bohr models of all the atoms that you have. Now, let me show you the Bohr models of first group elements. Observe it carefully. Before that, which are the first group elements? Tell me. Yes, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, and francium. And here are the Bohr models of all these atoms. Observe it carefully. So, what have you observed? Yes, very good. While moving from top to bottom, in that first group, what happens to the size, to the atomic size of the atoms? First group members, please tell me what happens to the atomic size. Yes, very good. The atomic size of the atoms increases. So from lithium to sodium, the size increases. And from sodium to potassium, the size increases. From potassium to rubidium, then cesium, then francium, the atomic size increases. So what may be the reason? All these atoms are first group elements, am I right? Yes. So all these atoms are first group elements, but their atomic size changes. And how it changes? It increases from top to bottom. So while moving from top to bottom in any group in our periodic table, here we have chosen first group elements, but it is the same in the case of all the groups. So in any groups in our periodic table, while we moving from top to bottom, the atomic size of the atoms increases. What may be the reason? Let us have one more look into these pictures. So here in lithium, what is the atomic number? Yes, the atomic number is 3 and the electronic configuration is, of course, 2,1. So there are two shells present in the lithium atom. So lithium atom has only two shells. But what about the sodium? It has three shells. In the case of potassium, it has four shells. Then what about rubidium? It has five shells, namely K, L, M, N, and O. And the cesium has six shells, namely K, L, M, N, O, P. So, while moving from top to bottom in any group, the number of shells in the atoms increases. The number of shells in the atom increases. And as a result, because of that, since the number of shells are increasing, the size of the atom also increases. In our previous example, while we considered the Bohr models of potassium and carbon, potassium has four shells, whereas the carbon has only two shells. That's why potassium looks bigger in size than carbon. Here too, in the same manner, in the same way, since the number of shells are increasing while moving from top to bottom in the periodic table in a group, the size of the atoms are also increasing. So, the size of the atoms increases in a group only because the number of shells are increasing. Okay, now let us consider what happens to this atomic size while moving from left to right in a period. Here you have the Bohr models of the second period element, namely lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine. So here you have the 8 members and just observe them carefully. What happens to the size of these atoms while moving from left to right? Yes, of course, you are very good. The size of the atoms decreases. What may be the reason? Okay, first group members, please tell me, how many shells are present in the lithium atom? Lithium atom has two shells. Second group element, what about beryllium? Beryllium also has two shells. Third group element, what about boron? Boron too has two shells. Fourth group member, in the case of carbon, how many shells are present? Two shells, very good. Carbon too has two shells. And the fifth group member, what about nitrogen? Nitrogen too has only two shells. So lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, and neon. All these elements are belong to the second period of the periodic table, and hence all of them have only two shells. All of them have only two shells. Then also, why their atomic size differs and how it differs. As you told that, from left to right, the atomic size decreases. So what may be the reason? In the case of the group, we told that, we recognized that since the number of shells are increasing, the atomic size also increases. But here, in the case of period, there is no change in the number of shells. Then also, the atomic size decreases while moving from left to right. So what may be the reason? Let us check. First of all, let us take lithium. The atomic number is 3. Study academy number so atomic number 3 means there are 3 protons present in the nucleus of this lithium atom. Am I right?
Yes.
So in lithium, the nucleus contains 3 protons. The nucleus contains 3 protons, which means the nuclear charge of lithium is 3. Nuclear charge is 3. So what mean by this nuclear charge? By using this nuclear charge, the nucleus attracts the electron towards itself. You know that. The proton present in the nucleus of an atom attracts the negatively charged electrons present in the shell of an of that atom. So these nuclear charges attract the electrons. What about beryllium? Beryllium, the atom number is 4, which means the nuclear charge is also 4. So comparing lithium and beryllium, which one has higher nuclear charge? Fourth group members, please tell me which one has higher nuclear charge. Very good, beryllium. So which one attracts their electron stronger than the other? Second group members, please tell me, considering lithium and beryllium, which one attracts their own electrons more powerfully? Very good, beryllium, because beryllium has nuclear charge 4, whereas lithium has only nuclear charge 3. So think the nuclear charge of beryllium is higher than lithium, beryllium atom attracts its electrons towards the nucleus more strongly than lithium. Am I right? Yes. Then let us have a look into the all the second period members. So we have lithium, the atom number 3, beryllium, 4, boron, 5, carbon, 6, nitrogen, 7, and oxygen, atom number 8, fluorine, atom number 9, and finally we have neon, fifth atomic number. Okay. So lithium has nuclear charge. Has a nuclear charge 4, boron has nuclear charge 5, carbon has nuclear charge 6. Likewise, while moving from left to right in the second period of the periodic table, the atomic numbers of the respective elements are increasing, and as a result, their nuclear charge is also increasing. Since the nuclear charges are increasing, the attraction of the nucleus over the electrons are also increases. The attraction of the nucleus over their electrons is also increases. And because of that increase in the nuclear attraction, the size of the atom decreases. So while moving from left to right in a period of the periodic table, the atomic numbers of the elements are increasing. As a result, their nuclear charge also increases. By using that nuclear charge, the nucleus attracts the electron towards itself. Since nuclear charges are increasing, the nuclear attraction also increases, and as a result, the size of the atom decreases. So that happens in a period, in any period of the periodic table, the size of the atom decreases while moving from left to right. Now, let me show you a video of how sodium chloride is formed by the combination of sodium and chlorine. So in this process, which atom donates electron? Very good. Sodium donates electron. Which one accepts or receives the electron? Very good. Chlorine atom accepts or receives the electron. So here, sodium donates electrons and chlorine receives electrons. But why? Why the sodium atom donates the electron and why the chlorine atom receives the electron? As we all know about the octet rule, am I right? Yes, octet rule. So in order to get stability, in order to form stable, atoms can either donate or receive or share electrons with one another. So let us have a look into the sodium chloride. We have both sodium and chlorine. What is the atomic number of sodium? 11. And the atomic number of chlorine is 17. Okay, what is the electronic configuration? Electronic configuration of sodium is 2, 8, 1, and that of chlorine is 2, 8, 7. Okay, how many electrons are present in the outermost shell of sodium? 1. And in the case of chlorine, 7. So, according to octet rule, an atom acquires stability if it has 8 electrons in its valence shell. Only if it has 8 electrons in its valence shell. So, in order to form stable, sodium donates these electrons to chlorine. So, after donation, the electronic configuration of sodium will be 2, 8, since this one electron, this outermost electron is donated. So 2, 8, now it has 8 electrons in its valence shell, so it becomes stable, that you know. And in the case of chlorine, it has received that one electron and now the electronic configuration is 2, 8, 8. How? Initially it has 7 electrons in the valence shell and now it got one more from sodium and finally now it has 8 electrons. So, in order to acquire that stability, sodium donated one electron and chlorine accepted that one electron. Now the question is, how sodium donated that one electron? We know that the nucleus of all the atoms attracts its electrons. So there is an attraction between the nucleus of sodium atom and this last electron. So the nucleus of sodium atom attracts these two electrons present in the K shell, these 8 electrons present in the L shell, and this one electron present in the M shell. So the nucleus attracts all the 11 electrons. So in order to donate this one electron, we have to break that attraction between the nucleus of the sodium atom and this valence electron. Since this electron is present in the outermost shell, we call it as the valence electrons. So we have to break that attractive force between the nucleus and the valence electrons. And this energy, the energy required to break that attractive force is known as ionization energy. So the energy required to break the attraction between the nucleus of an atom and its outermost electron. So, in another word, we can define this ionization energy as the minimum energy required to liberate the most loosely bonded electron from the outermost shell of an isolated gaseous atom. The minimum energy required to liberate the most loosely bonded electron The most loosely bonded electron means the outermost electrons, because it is far away from the nucleus compared to the other electrons. So this will be the most loosely bonded electron from an isolated gaseous atom. So ionization energy means the energy required to liberate the most loosely bonded electron from the outermost shell of an isolated gaseous atom. Now let me give you some activity cards. You have to find answers to the questions in that activity cards. So here is your activity cards. Read it carefully and find out the answers. We all know that in our periodic table there are two broad categorized elements, namely the metals and the non-metals. We know about the properties of metals and that of non-metals, but there are some other elements which shows the properties of both the metals and the non-metals. These elements like silicon, germanium, they shows the properties of metals and that of the non-metals, and that's why they are known as the metalloids. They are known as metalloids. They are known as metalloids. So metalloids have both the properties of metals and that of non-metals. They have the properties of metals and non-metals. So that's why they are known as metalloids. And I gave you two examples for metalloids, namely silicon and germanium. You have a follow-up activity. Tomorrow you have to find some more examples for metalloids and also their uses in our daily life. You all know about the uses of metals and the non-metals in our daily life. Now you have to find out some more metalloids and also their uses in our daily life. So that's the work for you tomorrow. I hope you enjoyed the class very well and you got everything clearly. So let us meet in our next class. Until then, see you. Bye.